support is provided by the Children's Hospital of Southwest Florida, part of the Lee Memorial Health System. Caring people, caring for people.
Hi, I'm Tyler.
I'm Kyra.
I'm Cody.
And I'm Riley. We're the host of Curious Kids. Welcome to our treehouse.
We're curious about a lot of stuff.
And we love to explore and make connections.
Yeah, from our backyard
to the world
and right back to ourselves and you.
Today we discovered how things have a way of going around and around.
Starting off with a bird tagging adventure.
Here we are at Babcock Ranch.
Come on, let's go see.
Babcock Ranch Preserve is more than 70,000 acres of land owned by the state of Florida. It's called a preserve because it is protected land that can't be built up. It's called a ranch because for almost 100 years, it's been a working ranch where beef cattle are raised. Because it's so big and undeveloped, it also gives Florida black bears and panthers a wild place to roam and live. But we're here for the birds.
It's the perfect place for Dr. Jackson, who's looking to catch some birds to tag. He's got Patty and Bob helping him today.
They place the nets close to bushes full of berries that the birds like to eat. Okay, nets are up. Now we just need a bird. Oh, here we go.
This is a gray catbird. And you can see that what happens, how that bird got caught, is that it was just flying just like this. Are we ready? And it was flying just like the sock. And when it hits the net folds over around it. So it's in a little pocket.
Oh, I didn't even see that.
And the bird is immobilized.
Now we've got a bird. Next step, banding it. The band is a small metal ring that's put on the bird's leg. Bands come on a string of wire.
There's a different size band for every bird. First you measure the size of the bird's leg to know what size band, then you open up the band and with special pliers clip it onto the bird's leg. Not so easy with a broken finger.
On the inside of the band it says, "Advise Fish and Wildlife Service, Washington, D.C. if you find this bird."
Once the bird's banded, Dr. Jackson records the number, then measures the beak, the wings, and the tail. Then he puts the bird in a sock and weighs it. So, why do they do all this?
It's important because of all the different things we can learn about them. We can learn about how big their populations are. We can learn how far these birds are traveling on their migration. We can learn whether they return to the same place, the same backyard, year after year, some of them do. We can learn how long they live. We can learn if they travel in pairs or in family groups. We can learn if they keep the same mate year after year.
Banding also helps scientists to track diseases carried by birds, like West Nile virus.
So then we got to hold the bird. This is what's called a photographer's grip. I don't think he likes me much. He seems to like Kyra better. Wow, we've got another bird. It's a palm warbler.
You can see it's got a little bit of green there, and under the tail it's got bright yellow.
It's a pretty little bird.
It's a beautiful little bird.
Where does it come from?
This one nests up in the northern Canada.
Wow.
It's a bird from the far north.
Have people in Canada found birds that were tagged here?
They certainly have. And fortunately, the Canadian Wildlife Service and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service work together in bird banding. They share all of the computer records. And biologists in Canada have to have a Canadian permit to band. Biologists in the United States have to have a U.S. permit to band.
How does such a little bird fly all the way here from Canada?
They have to have a lot of energy to do it. So what they do is to eat all day, and they put on a lot of fat. So they get really fat. Their body gets really heavy. And then they only fly at night.
Time to let this little bird go. Bye-bye, birdie.
How cool is that? You both got to hold a bird?
I know. I'm not sure the bird liked it much.
So do they just band birds all day long?
No, only in the morning, because that's when they're feeding.
Yeah, those birds were trying to eat the Brazilian pepper berries when they got caught in the net.
First the bird eat the berries, then the berries pass through the digestive tract, and ta-da, the seeds come out the other end.
Ew.
Oh, so the seeds hitchhike a ride with the birds to get to new places. Brilliant!
Yeah, and as Kelly and Aaliyah found out, seeds can travel a long way.
A fruit is like a suitcase for seeds.
Watermelons originated in Africa, and they were seen in Egyptian hieroglyphics 5,000 years ago.
And after spreading to all the Mediterranean countries, they were in China, and in 13 centuries arrived in Europe.
They showed up in America in the early 1600s, and Florida Indians were known to grow them not long after.
And now Florida is one of the leading producers of watermelons.
But best of all, they're really healthy for you and yummy.
All that from one little seed?
In the same way that birds spread seeds over large areas, people transport and share seeds too.
We recently visited a special farm right here in North Fort Myers that shares their seeds with farmers all over the world.
ECHO's goal is to provide training to people working with the poor to help reduce hunger. ECHO, E-C-H-O, stands for Educational Concerns for Hunger Organization.
Miss Ellen volunteers at ECHO, and she showed us around the farm where they grow foods for all kinds of different environments, like semi-arid, desert, or tropical.
They even figured out how to grow food on rooftops. That's called an urban garden.
But the urban garden has to do with cities. So this is a kind of garden that you would have in a city. There's a lot of people in the world that really can't afford to go to the grocery store because, you know, when we go to the grocery store, we buy our food, mm-hmm. but it all comes in lots of packages, and all those things cost a lot of money. So a lot of people can't afford all of that kind of thing, and so they have to grow part of their food.
Aside from vegetables, urban gardens include animals like chickens, rabbits, goats, and ducks. We got to feed the ducks.
But back to seeds. To learn about those, Miss Ellen took us to the ECHO Seed Bank to meet Miss Kimberly.
What exactly is an ECHO Seed Bank?
The seed bank is very much like a bank that holds money, but we have seeds. Seeds that we grow on the farm, seeds that we bring in from other farms and partner gardeners. And we save the seeds here and package them and distribute them to our network members.
So who are network members?
Network members are people all over the world working with the hungry and the poor. What we try to do in our seed selection is come up with something that's going to have the highest nutrition value for the people who are depending on it.
Miss Kimberly told us that ECHO has network members in 183 countries. Those are the people who report on whether the seeds grow well in their region. But before the seeds are ready to be sent out and packaged, they have to be cleaned and stored.
But wait a minute. How do they know if a seed is a good seed or a bad seed?
After we dry the seeds, we can float them in a beaker full of water. The seeds that are empty will rise to the top.
So is this it? After you're done with this, can you send the seeds?
Nope, this is just the beginning. And I can take you to talk to Miss Jennifer in germination to get the rest of the story.
Miss Jennifer's an intern, meaning she's doing supervised training as part of her education.
So what's the germination part on all of this?
Well, that's a good question. As Miss Kimberly was saying before, we don't want to send out seeds that are not likely to grow. So we test all of our seeds to make sure that they will germinate. And so that's what the germination room is all about.
Finally, after the seeds have been tested, they have to be stored. And as Riley found out, that can be a little chilly.
Storage room. It's really cold. Why do the seeds have to be kept so cold?
Well, the cold air preserves the seeds for a longer period of time and keeps them in a dormant stage.
How do you keep seeds if you have no refrigerator?
Saving seed is really simple. You just want to keep it safe from pests mm-hmm. or mice or other animals that might have some thievery going on. It's not complicated. We use the best facilities we can here at ECHO, but any farmer can save seed.
Storage bins vary in different countries. Here in the United States, grain is usually kept in large silos. In rural Africa, people build dome-like structures out of clay, so the seeds are kept cool and safe from pests.
Before we left ECHO, we went back to see Miss Ellen to learn more about urban gardens.
Growing food on a rooftop means you have to be really resourceful. ECHO teaches people how to reuse all kinds of things to help the roots of plants grow.
Over here, we're making use of some old carpet that somebody has thrown away and put in the garbage.
That's useful.
Yeah, so and just a little bit of soil there. And what happens, you see that bucket there? Mm-hmm. We turn it over, take the lid off, put some water and then some liquid, some food nutrients. So the bucket like this has a tiny hole in it. And when it's turned upside down, very, very, very slowly, the water and the nutrients come out. And this carpet acts like a wick.
Like a sponge?
Yeah, it acts just like a sponge. That's great. And then it just spreads out through this whole carpet in this bed so that the water and nutrients can get to the root of each plant.
Old tires make great planters for any garden, but wait a minute. Socks?
They are socks. We've taken bottles. Some old bottles that people have thrown away, and we've put them inside socks. And we cut off the top of this tire, and we've put a piece of plastic on the bottom, and we're putting them in here.
The socks and bottles, soda cans, and corn cobs all help to conserve water and allow the plant's roots to spread out. This urban garden really showed us how things can be reused in very productive ways.
Bye. Time to say goodbye. We thought it was pretty cool that the folks at ECHO are helping people around the world grow healthier food from all those tiny seeds.
Recycling, look at my new bag. Actually, it's not new because it's made of recycled juice boxes.
I love that. What a cool idea. A kid at my school made this belt out of those kinds of juice boxes.
Yeah, it's amazing what you can do with what you might think of as trash.
We went to visit the Ultimate Recycling Project, an entire castle made out of used stuff.
Hi, Mr. Solomon.
Welcome to Solomon's Castle. I'm Howard Solomon. I'm a wood carver, a metal sculptor, and an author. Wow. I have 22 other trades, and I've been building a castle since 1972. This is the queen, and that's the prince.
Good morning.
Wow. Wow. Do you all really live here?
Yes.
Wow.
This castle is
Whoa.
So cool.
That's amazing. Is everything here recycled?
Most of it.
I work with used materials, and this is what covers the outside of the castle. These are offset printing plates from our local newspaper.
Really?
Wow. Oh.
It's aluminum.
That's cool.
That's what makes it so
wow.
Everything you're going to see in the castle, I've made out of things people throw away, such as oil drums and car parts, broken appliances and beer cans.
So off we went on a fascinating journey through Mr. Solomon's curious castle. First stop, Flower Child, then Confusion? Mr. Solomon has some pretty funny names for his creations.
Yeah, and he makes art out of what most people see as just basic stuff. Like these cool creatures he made out of coat hangers.
I made 5 giraffes for other museums and private homes.
How long did that take?
A week. Oh, you bend one piece at a time. You know, you could bend a coat hanger. Mm-hmm. There's Captain
That's
Hook.
Amazing.
There was Trumpet Man, Sax Man, and Piano Man. Oh, and the fish that got away. But one of my favorites was this really cool carousel. Now, how on earth did he make that?
These are made from phonograph turntables. You know what those are? The phonograph turntables?
Oh,
the record
yes.
players?
Mm-hmm.
Each one has a wind-up music box inside.
Then we got to meet some really big and crazy creatures. This elephant is made out of 7 oil drums. Its toenails are clamshells, and the tusks are manatee ribs.
But what's a good castle without a dungeon?
Is there a dungeon here?
Yes, that's our dungeon.
Is that a ghost?
I
it's deep down there.
When the kids misbehave, we say you're going to see the babysitter, and they straighten right out. Our kids thought everybody had dungeons.
Are there any ghosts down there?
But before Mr. Solomon could answer, there was a weird noise that came up from the dungeon. It got louder and louder and...
It was definitely time to get some fresh air.
Then Mr. Solomon invited us to see his workshop. Phew.
Wow, this place is so cool.
It's big.
No, Waldo?
Oh, there's Waldo.
That's Waldo, that's Wilma.
There were a lot of tools in that workshop. It's where Mr. Solomon crafts all his unique art. He showed us how to make one of my favorite pieces, an owl. Ta-da! I had my very own owl.
Then we were off to the Alishmo, where Mr. Solomon stores some of his finished art pieces. Everything from cars and a tractor. To pop art?
This is 7 varieties of pop tops, so we call it pop art.
Did you ever hear of a mosquito house?
This is a genuine mosquito house. This will hold 25 skinny mosquitoes, and if they should gain weight, you bring it back to me and I'll add a room on the side. This is a do-nothing block.
A do-nothing
block, yeah.
What's it do?
See, it doesn't do nothing. Have you ever seen jumping jacks?
That's funny.
Do you know how to tune a fish can?
No.
You can't tune a fish. That's why the fish doesn't want you to play the scales.
I get it.
And last but not least...
The pet block has a higher IQ than the pet rock because they know how to float. And I've named all of these. This is old Frank Sinatra, Blue Eyes. Old Sammy Davis, One Eye. Casper the Friendly Block. H&R Block. Picasso's Pet Block. There's a road block. This is a sun block. That's a around the block. A writer's block.
I asked Mr. Solomon why he became an artist, and he said he was just born that way. But what inspired him to build a castle?
Well, I always thought that I was a king and I needed a castle.
Okay, a king who built a kingdom out of his own creativity. So next time you look at what seems like junk to throw away, think again. Time to say goodbye.
Goodbye. Thanks for coming.
Thank you. Let's go back to the treehouse.
That was an awesome castle.
Mr. Solomon was funny. I love my owl.
He's such a creative artist and sculptor. I couldn't believe how many things he's made.
I know. He must work day and night.
I don't think I'd want to stay overnight, though. Hey, where's Kyra?
She went to a school to learn how to play a very cool musical instrument and make some music.
The music class at Tommy Barfield Elementary School on Marco Island gets a special treat when local musician Mr. J. Robert comes by to teach them how to play the steel drums. The steel drums, or pans as they're called, are handcrafted from old 55-gallon steel drums that were used to transport fuels. The kids are playing a whole bunch of percussion instruments. They're getting a nice Caribbean feel to this familiar tune, The Lion Sleeps Tonight. The class starts off by learning basic rhythm. Mr. J. Robert got me started off on the bongos. Not too difficult. Now I've got it. Okay, next to the steel drums. I had never played them before, so I was a little nervous, but Jared was there to help me out.
Does it take a long time to play the steel drum to learn how to?
It really doesn't take a long time if you practice. You have to practice. Steel drum is an easy instrument to play. You can't hit the wrong note as long as you're within the realm of that key. So you can learn what the right notes are by playing lots of wrong notes.
I think I'll have to practice for a long time. but it's fun. You may have noticed I still have a broken finger. So if I can do it, I'm sure you can.
Trinidad is the beautiful land of my grandparents and most of my mom's family. My mom grew up in a village called Lebrae. Lebrae means tar in Spanish. And since the largest natural deposit of pitch is in Lebrae, I think it's a perfect name for the village.
I remember having so much fun swimming in the lake with my sister, under the watchful eye of the lake's guide, of course. The Republic of Trinidad and Tobago consists of two main islands situated in the southeastern West Indies, close to the continent of South America. Trinidad is often called the land of the hummingbird because more than 16 different species of hummingbirds have been seen there. They're even featured on the national coat of arms. Port of Spain is the capital city and is situated on the island of Trinidad. There are so many delicious fruits to eat there, including a local fruit called soursop, which you can see here next to the bananas. Street vendors selling coconuts are popular. These kids certainly seem happy with theirs. Trinidad has a tropical climate and is home to a lot of different animals and plants. The red dots in this picture are scarlet ibis birds. And these are the famous four-eyed fishes. One of my favorite places is Maracas Beach, and if you ever go, and you're brave, try the famous shark and bake. Basically, a shark sandwich. But back to the steel pan, which is the national instrument of Trinidad. A man called Elie Manette created the first steel pans from 55-gallon oil drums back in the late 1930s. The development of his drums to their present state was kind of random and accidental. He'd make a drum, then realize he needed a new note, so he'd have to make a new drum. He kept going until the complete drum was made. We're sure glad he did because the music they make is wonderful.
This is a piece of tar or asphalt from the Pitch Lake where I used to go swimming. I think it's really cool that the same stuff that caulked Sir Walter Raleigh's ship is now being used to pave roads all over the world. I love my Trinidadian heritage and hope to go back there really soon.
The Golisano Children's Museum will be opening soon in Naples.
It's going to have some really cool exhibits, including a curious kids space, so we'll be spending a lot of time there.
An interesting fact about the museum is that it will be a LEED Green Building, certified by the United States Green Building Council.
To find out what that means exactly, we checked in with Miss Hallie. She's the Curious Kids Coordinator at the Children's Museum. She did a workshop on green construction with the kids from our CMA school in Immokalee.
Green buildings try to recycle different materials, and they try to reuse old materials from other buildings so that we're not chopping down more and more trees or using more and more energy.
So what kind of materials are they using? Some of them might surprise you, like eco rocks made out of squash tires that are used for flooring. Coconut husks woven together are used to make rugs. Bamboo for flooring, and sawdust?
This is something called marmoleon, and this is what all our floors are gonna be made out of. And this is made out of sawdust. It's sawdust and resin smashed together.
Then there was a really cool looking one.
Glass and concrete. This is called ice stone. Now this is going to make up all of our counters at the museum.
There are even materials from one very cuddly animal.
Wool is made from
sheep.
Very good. So this actually came from sheep. And when we get wool, we don't hurt the sheep, we just shear it off. So this is a wool rug, and we'll have wool rugs at the museum.
And finally, did you ever wonder where your old blue jeans might end up?
This is called bat insulation. And we put it behind walls. Okay? Now, this is actually made out of blue jeans. That's why it's blue.
So when you do get to visit the new Golisano Children's Museum when it opens in Naples, think about all those recycled materials that make it a really cool building.
Get up, get out, get active.
To be strong and live well, we have to make healthy choices in our lives. Eating the right kinds of food is very important.
And making sure to get some daily exercise, too. We had a great workout when we visited a local Zumba class given by Miss Evelyn.
Ready to Zumba today?
Yeah!
Woo! Okay! Let me tell you a little bit about Zumba. Zumba is a dance fitness class.
okay? And we're going to be traveling through some different countries and learning about some different dance rhythms.
Miss Evelyn showed us how it's done. From the punches to the feet.
Pony and over, over.
Time for the music.
Good.
It didn't take long for some of our curious kids to get the moves.
That's it!
Of course, some of us got it quicker than others. Jake had some air guitar happening.
Ready?
And Raphael's going around and round.
Ooh, there you go.
In the end, we were all looking pretty good.
There you go.
And having fun.
Over. Woo! Looking.
Finally, the Chihuahua had us all in the spirit of Zumba and getting the exercise we needed. Final word.
Zumba!
Trinidad and Florida have a lot in common when it comes to fruits.
So we thought we'd share an idea we have for a Caribbean fruit salad.
It is really easy to make, and all these fruits grow right here in Florida.
We prepared all the foods before the show. So remember, kids, always ask your grown-up to help you prepare any foods.
We got watermelons, mangoes, papayas, bananas.
Avocados, yes, they're fruit. Carambola, sometimes known as the star fruit. Some shredded coconut, some lemon juice, and last but not least, a little bit of honey.
Ta-da! We mix it all up, and yum, it tastes great.
It sure does. It may look good for us, but let's find out from a dietitian.
Well, Jake and Raphael, color me healthy. That fruit salad is just as healthy and delicious as it is colorful. Do you know why it is important to eat from all the colors of the rainbow? Well, I'll tell you why. For example, watermelon. Watermelon is high in carotenoids. No, not carrots. Carotenoids, these are antioxidants to keep your cells healthy and strong. Mangoes are high in vitamins A, C, and E. Bananas, high in potassium. And star fruit and papaya are high in vitamin C. Oh yeah, and coconut is high in those B vitamins. So that's why it's important to eat from all the variety of the colors of the rainbow to keep you healthy and strong.
I want to try that fruit salad.
I want to go back to Zumba. That was fun.
I love the way Miss Evelyn used dances from around the world in her Zumba class.
Around and around.
Yeah, we learned that from seeds to castles, green buildings to gardens and steel drums.
When we reuse and recycle, just like nature does, we help to keep things going around and around.
And by being creative and resourceful, we can reduce our footprint and help others.
See you next time.